Hello, everyone, and welcome to Queens Public Library. Today's program is Urban Wildlife Safari. My name is Joanne, and I'm one of the librarians at the Hunters Point Library. Before we begin today's program, just a few notices. QPL is open for to-go service, so you can pick up and return materials at a number of locations. To learn more about our to-go services, other virtual QPL programs, accessing digital services, or getting an e-card, please visit queenslibrary.org. You can take QPL with you wherever you are as well. Our digital materials are available 24/7 from anywhere with an internet connection. This year, QPL is also celebrating our 125th anniversary, so look out for special programs, challenges, book lists, and more. We are proud to have served the people of Queens since 1896, providing our customers with the resources they need to advance in their lives. We do want to mention that this is one of the many programs that we are hosting as part of the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center, and this will be happening periodically on Saturdays at 2 p.m. on YouTube Live. Our next event is on March 13th, Nature and the Effect on Sustaining Better Mental Health Care, so check the comments as I'll be putting the link in very shortly. And for our younger community members, we have a Science Everywhere program on YouTube Live that happens on Tuesdays at 4 p.m. Our next one is on March 24th, where we will have a fun story and science activities you can do at home, as we will be talking about everyone's favorite tree sap, maple syrup. So set a reminder in the links that I'm going to put in the chat below. Last thing I need to mention is that these programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Now for today's program, which I'm really excited for, explore the streets of New York City and some of our most amazing parks on this virtual safari to look for animal habitats and wildlife signs all around us. And so it is my pleasure to officially introduce River DeLeo, who is the Regional Environmental Educator for New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Their interactive programs focus on appreciating local ecosystems, enjoying outdoor recreation, and committing to environmental stewardship. As a note, please check the description below, as River has kindly provided additional resources that you can check out, as well as more information about the Department of Environmental Conservation. And if you have any questions for River, please write them in the live chat, drop a hello, as we will be also having an audience Q&A at the end of this session. So without further ado, River, you can take it away.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Joanne, for all of your help with the technical side of things. And I also want to thank Queens Public Library and Hunters Point Environmental Education Center for this opportunity for me to share our programs and introduce you to some of the wildlife here in New York City. So my name is River DeLeo. I am the environmental educator for New York State Department of Environmental Conservation, and I cover the five boroughs of New York City. Here in New York City, we do have a lot of animal habitat that I am excited to share with you, and the program that I am doing today is also available for school groups and homeschool groups, scout groups, virtually to anyone who is interested. My email address is there on the screen, so you can check it out and send me an email if you are interested in this program. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. So here we have a basic question that I'm sure you might be able to answer, but the question is, can wildlife live in New York City? And when I walk from my apartment to the train, I see lots of plants and trees, but I don't often see animals. But I know that animals live in my neighborhood because there are, it is a good habitat for animals. We'll just have to take a look at some of the signs and clues that those animals leave behind. So animals live in New York City because they can find food, water, and shelter here. Food, water, and shelter are the three things that animals need to survive. We also need these things to survive. And when food, water, and shelter are all together and they are in the same place and animals can access them, we call that a habitat. So these are animal habitats have to have food, water, shelter in the right amounts for an animal to be able to survive there. So when we think of resources and a habitat for wildlife, you might have a certain idea in your head of what that wildlife habitat looks like. And that it might look like a pristine wilderness area with lots of food for animals, lots of clean water, lots of large open spaces. And that's true. These are all great places for animals to live, but they can also live here in New York City. It's just that the resources that they are finding look a little bit different here in the city compared to more open wilderness areas. So animals that are in New York City are finding their food, water, and shelter in some interesting places. So you might recognize some of these animals here. You can see a raccoon is getting some food, presumably, out of this recycling bin here. We see some birds right below the raccoon getting a bath, getting some water out of a bird bath that someone has set up. And then we have in the upper right-hand corner is a cardinal getting some food from a bird feeder. And then in the lower right is a rabbit that is eating some clover. So these are animals that are finding their food, water, and shelter in our neighborhoods right here in our habitats. So as we look for the animals, we can try to see where these elements of their habitat might be. And they're able to find their food, water, shelter in places where people might have left it out for them on purpose or on accident. So the raccoon's habitat there is a little bit on accident. They can get into garbages pretty easily. And sometimes food and water is put out for animals on purpose. And we'll talk about that, what that looks like coming up. So when you're looking for animals and you're thinking about their habitats, it's different in a city versus a wild habitat. So we're going to make that distinction here today between urban habitats and wild habitats. There's still wild animals that live in cities, but just to make that distinction, we're going to say urban habitats are in cities. Doesn't have to be a city as big as New York City, but anywhere where there are people and big buildings and lots of traffic, we're going to call that an urban habitat. And then a wild habitat is more where there's not so many people around and animals have more space to roam. So here we have an example of an urban habitat on the left. That is a path going through a park. This path was built for people to walk down and enjoy the forest, look for animals, enjoy the outdoors. So this is part of a path in Manhattan, in Inwood Park. And then on the right is a more of a wild habitat, but they're still both forests. They're still both providing the food, water, and shelter that animals need to survive. They just look a little different based on how much is built for people to be enjoying the space. Here we have an urban habitat that you might see right outside your apartment. So even trees that are along the street can be a spot for animals to live, to find their food, water, shelter. Animals like birds might be up in the tree. We can look for nests that are in trees. And even along the bark, we can find evidence of birds that might have been there a while ago. We can maybe see some holes left behind from a woodpecker or from an insect. We can look down at the base of the tree to look for animal signs that might be right around the base of a tree, maybe a hole that goes under the tree, or insects that have made homes at the bottom of the tree, spider webs we can look for, and in the grass at the bottom of a tree. So even if you're walking down the street, you are passing some animal habitat. You're passing some spots where you can look for these animal clues, and you can start to get to know the neighbors that are in your neighborhood a little bit better. I also want to point out that when we're talking about these habitats where animals live and we're talking about the parks where they are, the parks could be really small parks, pocket parks they're sometimes called, or they can be big botanical gardens. So you don't have to make a special trip to a big park to look for these animals. You can just pass by a corner park or a small park in your neighborhood to take a look and see what you can see out there. So even if it is a spot that is mostly designed for people, you will be able to find some animals there. And a really cool story I wanted to tell here is there's a pretty small park in Manhattan called Tompkins Square Park, and it's on the Lower East Side, and it looks a lot like the picture on the left here. There's a lot of fences and paths and tons of people that are out there if the weather is nice. And there are some animals that make their home there in Tompkins Square Park. So there are a lot of rats in Tompkins Square Park, and you can see the holes that they make in the ground, and you can often see them there. If you're there at sunset or at nighttime, you can see the rats in the park. It is, unfortunately for some, a spot that has the right habitat for rats. It has food, water, and shelter for rats. But because the rats are there, Tompkins Square Park is also home to a pair of red-tailed hawks. So it is so cool to see the red-tailed hawks. They sit up in the trees, they're not very far away, and usually you can find the red-tailed hawks if you look for the people with binoculars. So the red-tailed hawks have a pretty big fan club there in Tompkins Square Park, and on a nice sunny day, you might see a group of folks with binoculars. So even if you don't have binoculars, you might get a look at the red-tailed hawks if you follow the people that are looking for the hawk. So that is a good example of finding a surprising animal in a spot that you might not expect. So the park is very small. Red-tailed hawks usually need a pretty large area to hunt, but because there are so many rodents in that park, the hawks have plenty of food. I'm pretty sure that they nested in the park last spring, and I'm definitely looking forward to heading out to that park in a couple months and seeing if I can see the hawks, see the nest, and maybe even see their young in the nest. So when you get to know your park and know the animals that are there, you start to look forward to different parts of the year when those animals are going to be moving, migrating, nesting, and making themselves more visible. Here is an example of a couple other parts of New York City that have really good habitat. So we saw the picture on the left already. This is a part of Central Park. So you can see those big tall buildings in the back, but here is a little area that is was made by people. This is not a natural pond or a natural lake. This is all made by people, but it still provides habitat. It still provides that food, water, shelter for animals. So this is a really good spot in Central Park to look for animals that need the water. So you might see, I think if I look closely on my screen, I can see a couple little ducks in that water. This is also a good spot to see a heron. A heron is a kind of tall water bird that stands in the water with tall, skinny legs, and it can actually feel when a fish or a frog swims by, and it uses a sharp beak to eat that fish or frog that is swimming by. So it becomes a habitat for the fish and the frogs. It also becomes a habitat for animals that might eat those fish or frogs. And that includes raccoons. So this is another good spot to wait until sunset to stand up on that bridge and look to see if you can see raccoons hanging out at the edge of the water there. And on the right-hand side of your screen is a park that you might not recognize, but we're going to talk about it in a minute. This is Mount Loretto State Unique Area on Staten Island. And this picture is an example of an ecotone. An ecotone is the barrier between two different kinds of habitat. So on that picture, you can see a forest habitat and a grassland habitat. And where the forest and grassland meet is called an ecotone, E-C-O-T-O-N-E. Ecotone is where two habitats meet, and that is a really good spot to look for animals because they can find lots of different kinds of food in those two different habitats, in those two different ecosystems. If they hang out at the edge of those two ecosystems, they can get the best of both worlds. So ecotones are a really good place to look for animals, to look for a high amount of biodiversity, different kinds of animals all in the same area because they can find what they need to survive in that spot. All right. So now we're going to start to talk about the kinds of animals that you can find in the city. And the one that I always like to start with is birds. Birds are really easy to find. They're in all of our neighborhoods, and they're just a really great place to start with looking for animals in urban habitats. Hunters Point Environmental Education Center has done a whole program on birds. So if you look back in the YouTube channel, you can find a birding video there that's gonna focus in on birds and birding. So I'll point you in that direction to learn more. I'm just gonna spend a little bit of time talking about birds here. So birds are able to survive in New York City really well because of the habitat that is here. And if you think about the bird, if you can think about a bird that has the highest population in New York City, what do you think it is? What bird do you think there's more of in New York City than any other bird? It's almost, as soon as you think of New York City, you might think about this bird. It is a pigeon. So pigeons are very common in New York City. They're also called rock doves. And they love hanging out in New York City because it mimics their natural habitat. So pigeons are an animal, a bird that is used to putting their nest up on a cliff. So if there was no New York City here, they would be building their nests on the edge of cliffs. And they don't build a big giant nest. It's really just a couple little branches or leaves in a small area. And then they lay their eggs on the edge of a tall cliff. And that might seem dangerous to put your babies on the edge of a cliff there, but it keeps the babies safe from predators. So birds of prey or foxes or coyotes that might try to eat a baby rock dove is not going to be able to get to them because they are up on this cliff. And if you think about all of the buildings and bridges, all of the structures that make New York City a city, they can mimic cliffs. So pigeons are up underneath bridges. building their nests there. They're building their nests at the top of, on the roofs of buildings, and they're perched along windowsills, on the outside of windowsills, to look for food, to communicate with each other, to find a mate. So we've kind of accidentally created a perfect habitat for pigeons. And that's because the city looks a lot like cliffs to them. There's lots of places for them to safely keep their nests and lots of food for them to eat. But don't worry, pigeons are not the only birds that you can find in New York City. So here is just a tiny sample of the other species of birds that you can find here. In New York City, there's more than 200 species of birds that you can see in our parks, in our neighborhoods, and along the waterfront. And the key to seeing different kinds of birds is to understand where you are, to understand the habitats that are around you and what birds are attracted to what habitats. So we're gonna go through these birds here and I'll tell you habitats where you can find them. So the two on the far left are both birds that you're gonna find near the water. So the top one is an egret. Egrets look a lot like herons. They're related to each other and they both have long, skinny legs for standing in the water and for feeling when fish or frogs swim past their legs and hunting those fish or frogs with that long, sharp beak. So the long, sharp beak is an adaptation that those birds have to get the food that they need. And the food is in the wetlands and marsh areas around New York City. So you can find herons, you can find egrets. Sorry for that noise. I am in Brooklyn, so my habitat is very loud. So this picture is an egret, but it looks a lot like a heron. And then below the egret is a shorebird. So shorebirds is a group of birds that are all found along the beach. So this is an oyster catcher. And the oyster catcher is a good clue. You're going to find this animal in marine habitats, along the water, and they're really they stand out because of that bright orange beak and that bright orange beak they use to dig through the sand to get their food. So this is a shorebird. And if you're going to a beach, you can keep an eye out for this bird, the oyster catcher. So the rest of the birds are all birds that you can find in forested areas. The two in the middle, the top middle is called a gray catbird. And a gray catbird is a bird that is hard to see, but if you listen, you can hear gray catbirds a lot more than you'll see them. So they like to hide in bushes. They like to hide in the plants along the side of a trail, but they make a meowing noise. They sound like a cat or like a crying baby. So if you listen, you can hear the catbirds as you walk around a park. And the bottom middle is a tree swallow. Tree swallows, they fly like little tiny jet fighter planes. They hunt for insects on the wing. So they are, they'll fly through swarms of insects and catch insects on the wing. And to watch them fly is just magnificent. Really cool. You'll see them flying over water and perch along the sides of a pond or a stream. The upper right-hand corner is a red-winged blackbird. Really easy name there to remember if you see that picture, red-winged blackbird. These birds are often found along the edges of water, and I look forward to hearing this bird every year because it is a migrating bird. It comes here in the spring, and when I go to some water in New York City and I hear red-winged blackbirds, I know that spring is on its way. And then below the red-winged blackbird is a house finch. And house finch is a bird that has that really thick beak because it eats seeds and it needs to crush up seeds with that thick beak. So it's eating seeds from trees or from bird feeders. So that house finch is one that you'll see in forests. So it's not just birds that live in New York City. There's also mammals, amphibians, and reptiles in New York City. And our most common mammal might just be a squirrel. And squirrels we can see outside of our apartment windows, on walks to the subway, we might see squirrels all over the place. But squirrels are not the only mammal that live here. So here we have a picture of a coyote. Coyotes are pretty common in Queens, and they're being seen a lot around the airports in Queens. Here we have a raccoon on the bottom that is climbing its way out of a dumpster, presumably finding some food there in that dumpster, but raccoons can be found in all five boroughs because there's the right habitat for it everywhere. And then on the bottom there are white-tailed deer. Now, white-tailed deer are pretty recent migrant to New York City. They were not found in New York City 10 years ago. There weren't too many of them around, but they actually swam over from New Jersey to Staten Island, and the population of white-tailed deer on Staten Island has really exploded. There's so many white-tailed deer on Staten Island. People are seeing them more and more and needing to be careful as they drive around because there's so many deer on Staten Island. And besides mammals, there's also amphibians and reptiles here in New York City. So that frog that you're seeing on the bottom is a bullfrog. And just like the catbird, you're going to hear a bullfrog probably before you see it. It kind of sounds like mooing, like a cow mooing. And that's how it gets its name. And then in the upper left is a garter snake. Garter snakes are super common. You'll see them on sunny days out in the open getting some sunlight, and lots of people call them garden snakes, but that's not their name. Their name is garter snakes, that ends with an R. So garter snakes is a reptile that lives in New York City, and they're in all five boroughs, and they really like to hang out near rocks that warm up so that they can warm up. And I wanted to introduce you to this really cool amphibian called an Atlantic Coast leopard frog. So this is a brand new species that was just discovered. It was discovered in 2014 in Staten Island. So a whole new species of frog discovered right here in New York City is pretty exciting and pretty cool. And the reason it looks a lot like northern leopard frogs. So a northern leopard frog is very widespread in the United States and Canada. But this is a different species, and scientists found out that it's a different species by testing the DNA, by doing genetic testing on the frog, and found out that it's a totally different species. And that frog was discovered right here in New York City. So now we're going to go over a couple rules for watching wildlife. So when you go out on your New York City or urban safari, these are some things to keep in mind. So we want to give animals space. Giving animals space is very important because if an animal gets stressed out and needs to run away, it's using a lot of energy to do that. It's getting scared, its heart's beating faster, and it needs to run away. And every time animals use up energy, they need to go out and find food to replace that energy. It's not as easy for animals as it is for us. They need to hunt their food or climb trees to get their food. So we want to make sure that we're giving animals enough space. And usually the bigger an animal is, the more space that it needs away from a person in order to feel safe. So we want to give animals lots of space, not get too close to them. The next thing is do not disturb the animal. Don't scare the animal, don't run up on the animal, and do not feed animals. This is really, really important because it helps keep animals wild. It helps keep them healthy and able to find their own food. So when I go to parks in New York City, a lot of times I will see people feeding the animals and they're having a good time. It looks like the animals are having a good time because they're eating the food, but it's not good for the animals and it's not good for the people. And I'll tell you why. When you feed animals, most of what you're giving animals, especially birds. I see people feeding bread to birds, and that is like getting a whole meal of junk food. It's all junk food, and it's okay to eat it once in a while, but if birds keep on eating bread, they're not getting the nutrients that they need. So bread is not good for birds. It is not good to feed animals bread. It does not have the nutrients that they need to survive, and their whole belly fills up with junk food, and they don't have room for good, healthy food. And another reason why we don't want to feed animals is because then those animals get used to people. They come up to people thinking that they're going to get food. They might stop trying to find food on their own, and they might scare other people. So if you feed animals over and over again, those animals start coming up to people and they could scare people. And when animals are acting weird, sometimes when an animal is acting weird, we call 311 and they come and see if that animal is sick. So sometimes you can make other people think that the animal is sick by feeding it, and they just get too used to people. Coming up to people is not good for animals. So we want to not feed animals. Don't scare animals, but do not feed animals. So that's really, really important. It's also the law. You should not feed animals. And the last thing is be responsible. So think about these animals are out in their habitat, which is another word for home. So we want to be respectful of the animals' homes when we're in the parks and looking for them, which means we're not picking leaves off of plants. We're not leaving litter in the park. We're not scaring animals out of their homes. We want to be responsible and understand that these animals are our neighbors. And why do we have all these rules? Why do we have all these rules when we're talking about animals and trying to see them in their habitat? Well, we have these rules because animals are an important part of our community. They provide services that we would not be able to have without them. So some services that animals provide are worms that fertilize the soil and aerate the soil so that plants can grow, or bees that pollinate our gardens, that pollinate flowers and help flowers to grow. So animals are an important part of our neighborhood, and they're always doing things they're often doing things that are helpful to us without us even knowing. So that's why we want to be careful with the animals in our neighborhood. Another thing to understand, our animals are all connected to each other in a food web. And if we hurt one part of the food web, it can affect other parts. So some people don't like spiders, and it's okay if you don't like spiders, but don't kill spiders when you see them outside, because birds depend on spiders for their food. So it's important to understand that all of these things are connected when we go outside and look for animals. So the next slide is about how to increase your chances of seeing wildlife. So you know what the rules are, and now we're going to go over a couple things that will help us see more wildlife. I can't guarantee that you'll see a Sasquatch on your trips around New York City. But if you want to see some of the other animals that we talked about, here are some tips. So you want to leave your pets at home. It is nice to walk around a park with your dog, but if you're looking specifically for wildlife, you want to leave a dog at home because the dog will scare wildlife and make it harder to see. Also, you want to blend in as much as possible. You can wear camouflage if you want, but you want to try to walk quietly and be quiet as you walk through. The next thing is to have a target in mind. So when I get to the end, I'm going to talk about different parks around New York City, and I'm going to tell you what habitats are there. Once you know the habitat, you can have a target in mind of what animals might be there based on the habitat and the time of year. So I'm going to show you how to do that in a minute. And then the last part is know the signs of those target animals. You might not see the animal at first, but you might see signs that that animal has left behind. So I want you to think about, what is a clue that an animal might leave behind? So even if you can't see the animal, you might see this clue that the animal has left behind. Do you have an idea of what kind of clues animals leave behind? The first one is scat. So animals leave behind scat. Scat is the science word for poop, and animals leave scat around, and it is a really good sign for us to be able to tell what animals are in that habitat. So we never want to touch scat with our hands, but we can poke it with a stick and learn more about the animals that are there. So the scat of different animals looks different, and once you study it, you can actually tell what the animal is based on the size and shape of the scat. So scat is pretty funny to talk about, pretty funny to look at, but you can actually, it's really important, scientists learn about animals by looking at the scat, especially endangered animals. So if there are endangered animals in an area, we want to make sure that we're not disturbing the animals. So looking at the scat is really important. We could tell how healthy the animal is, and we could tell where it is sleeping or what it's eating based on the scat, and we don't have to disturb the animal itself. So scat is actually really important to scientists, and if you want to grow up and become a scientist that studies scat, you would be a scatologist. A scatologist is a scientist that studies scat. So the next clue that we look at for animals, if we want to see the clues that this animal has left behind, are tracks. So animal tracks are left behind, and we can see them in different areas based on what is covering the ground. So my favorite time to go out and look for tracks is right after it snows. Right after it snows, I love to go to my local park, which is Sunset Park here in Brooklyn, and see if I can see tracks in the snow. The ones that I see the most are in the upper left-hand corner. The gray squirrel tracks that I find tell me where the gray squirrels have gone. They're going up in trees. But you can also see tracks in sand, in mud, and at beaches. A lot of times you can see tracks of the animals that are visiting the beaches. So tracks are a really great way for us to see what animals are around. And if you want to study them more, you can tell so much, not just what the animal is, but sometimes you can tell how old the animal is by the tracks. That's pretty wild. White-tailed deer, if it's a young white-tailed deer, it's much smaller and not as deep of a track. But if it's an old adult white-tailed deer, it's going to be a deep, large track. Sometimes you can tell if the animal is running, and you might even be able to tell if the animal was eating something. It might leave clues of what it ate behind. So there are lots of other signs between tracks besides tracks and scat that we can look for. And here are some examples of that. So we can find homes that the animals have left behind. These can be a den. So the upper right-hand corner is a den. A den is a hole that's dug in the ground that the animal lives in for some part of its life. So this is a pretty big den. Maybe there's a bear that's in there. There's no bear in New York City. But foxes are in New York City, and foxes like to live in dens as well. Then below the den is an animal home that you might have seen. This is very common. If you look up in trees, especially this time of year when there's no leaves, this is the best time to look for these animal clues. This is up in a tree, and it looks like a giant ball of leaves. And you might think this is a nest, but it's not a nest. This is a home for a squirrel. So most squirrels are inside of trees, but if there's not enough room inside of trees for all of the squirrels in a habitat, they will make their home on the branches. And it's not called a nest, it is called a dray, D-R-E-Y. Dray is the home for a squirrel in a tree. And it's much messier than a nest. It has all these leaves all over the place. The other larger picture on the left is a nest. It's a pretty messy nest. So my guess is that this is a robin's nest. They tend to make pretty messy nests, but mostly twigs, a few leaves, not as big and messy as the squirrel. So the Next set of clues that animals leave behind are pieces of the animals' actual bodies that they leave behind. So sometimes animals shed their fur or their feathers, or they leave shells behind after they hatch out of shells. So these are also signs that we can look for carefully. And these are other things that we do not want to touch with our hands. We cannot bring them home, but we can take pictures and we can look very closely at them before we leave the park, and we can try to figure out what animals they were. So a question you might have is, can I look for animals year round? And here this fox is finding an animal underneath the snow. This is how fox hunt in the snow. They listen. So you see that fox listening for the animal that's under the snow and then jumping and trying to catch it, because that's how the fox gets its food in the wintertime, is being able to listen for the animals under the snow. So yes, we can see wildlife year round. We already talked about how you can look for animal tracks in the snow. Another thing to remember is different times of year, animals are doing different things. So as long as you have that target species in mind, or you're thinking about what time of year it is, that's going to help you be able to see what is around based on the time of year. And we're coming up on one of the most exciting times of the year for looking for animals in New York City, and that is spring migration. So this picture, these are actually bats in the background here, but I just love this picture. We can see all of these bats all moving together, and anytime animals are moving back and forth from a location to a new spot in a regular pattern, we call that migration. We're most familiar with birds migrating north and south because of winter and summer and wanting to be in different habitats for winter and summer. And that doesn't have to do with it being too cold. That has to do with it them not being able to find their food in different times of the year. So animals usually go north for the winter and then come, they go north for the summer and then come down south for the winter. But anytime animals all move together on a regular schedule, it's called migration. So even migration can happen every day. One of the largest migrations that happens is every day animals move up and down in the water column of the ocean. So they'll move up in parts of the day and then back down to darker water in other parts of the day. And that is a huge migration that happens every day. So spring migration is coming up in New York City, and it's a great way to see lots of different kinds of birds. So when you go on your safari, there's some things that you're going to want to bring. Water, snacks, your cell phone for taking pictures, maybe binoculars if you have them but you don't need them. A map is good. Some field guides. Field guides are books that tell you about the plants and animals in an area. And a journal. I love to keep track of the animals that I'm seeing. One cool program that is out there is called iBird New York. iBird New York is a contest where people try to see 10 different species of birds and mail in their contest form, and you'll get a certificate back that you are an iBird New York birder. And you could win some pretty cool bird prizes if you join that program. So you can just Google iBird New York and you'll find the website for that. So now we're going to go through some of the parks that I love to visit in New York City and the habitats that are there for different animals. So we're going to start with the Bronx. So I'm going to show you each borough and some parks that are in each borough. And here you can see that I've pointed out the park and the habitats. These aren't all the habitats that you can find in each park, but it's good to think about what habitats are there, because that will tell you what animals that you can look for. So you can do some of your animal identification before you even get to the park. So here we're going to talk about Pelham Bay Park and Starlight Park, which are both in the Bronx. So the first one is Pelham Bay Park. I love this park so much. It's huge and it's right along the ocean. So the habitats that are here are tidal wetlands. Tidal wetlands means they're very wet some time of the day and then they get drier. The water moves up and down with the tides. and there are plants growing in that tidal wetland. It creates a lot of really great habitats for birds. And then there's also tidal pools in Pelham Bay. Tidal pools is the picture on the right-hand side where it's covered with water when the tide comes up, and then the water drains out when the tide goes down, but it leaves these pools, and you can actually walk along the rocks and look in the pools and see all kinds of really cool algae and animals that are in the ocean that you wouldn't be able to see on dry land, but because they're in those pools, you can check them out closer. Pelham Bay Park is really, really cool. Oops, we went too far in our presentation here. So that's Pelham Bay Park. And the next park in the Bronx is Starlight Park. This is a teeny tiny park that is along the Bronx River. And I wanted to point this out because it is a park that is being developed. It's already there. You can visit, you can canoe or kayak. You see that canoe there up in the Bronx River. So canoeing is a really great way to see parks and check out rivers. But I like to point out this park because it is still being developed. And when a park is being developed, there's an opportunity for the community to have a say in what that park is going to look like. So if there's a park in your neighborhood, you can Google it up and see if there's new developments happening or opportunities for you to say, have a say in what happens to your local parks and to those animals' habitats. Next, we're going to talk about Manhattan. So Manhattan has Central Park, which we all know about, but I want to show you the North Woods and then also Riverbank State Park. So the North Woods of Central Park is in the northwest corner, and it's a really great spot to look for birds during spring migration. There's a really great documentary called The Central Park Effect, all about how birders go to Central Park to look for birds, and they're looking in this spot a lot. The next is Riverbank State Park in Manhattan. And here, this is along, it's called Riverbank State Park, but it is along the Hudson River, which is not actually a river, it is an estuary. So an estuary is different from a river in that it is connected to the ocean in a way that makes it have tides. So the water goes up and down with the tides. So the habitat here is the estuary, and you can often see really cool birds of prey along the river. Along the estuary, I should say. In Queens, we have Jamaica Bay, which is along the ocean, and there's really great wetlands at Jamaica Bay. And there's also Forest Park in Queens that is one of my favorite spots to go in the fall to look for fall foliage, beautiful trees turning all different colors. So Jamaica Bay Wildlife Refuge is a national wildlife refuge, and there are really great wetland habitats. You might recognize that bird. Do you remember the name of that bird? That is an egret in that picture. And then there's also horseshoe crabs, are crabs that are along the ocean there. These animals are have been around since before dinosaurs. They're really cool animals that come up on the beach to mate every spring. And there's lots of really cool habitat there along the ocean. And then Forest Park has a lot of great trees, fall foliage, really great birds to look at in the spring. And there's also a pond and wetlands. These folks in this picture are on a special program, so you shouldn't go into the water unless you're in a special program like that. But there are opportunities to get a closer look at the animals that live in the ponds. So for Brooklyn, there's Greenwood Cemetery, which is really close to me, and Marine Park, which is really pretty wetland area along the ocean as well. So you might not think about a cemetery as a place to look for animals, but it is. Greenwood Cemetery actually has a very weird population of parrots. For some reason, they might be an escaped pet, but there's monk parrots that live in the giant arched entryway of Greenwood Cemetery on Fifth Avenue. So a weird animal to see, but there's lots of birds that visit Greenwood Cemetery. You could see the pond there. I often see egrets and herons in Greenwood Cemetery. Then we have Marine Park. They have lots of canoeing at Marine Park, lots of chances to get close to the water, and lots of open grassland for birds. And lastly, But not least is Staten Island. There's so many parks on Staten Island. If you don't visit Staten Island often and you want to see animals, I highly recommend checking out some of these parks. There's a whole ring of parks in the middle of Staten Island called the Green Belt. And part of that ring is High Rock Park that has lots of forests and ponds. And Mount Loretto on the south shore of Staten Island has amazing grassland habitat. So Mount Loretto is right along the ocean, but this grassland habitat, that's the smallest picture there, is managed for birds that do not have a lot of other places to live. So they need to be in a grassland. They need to have that wide open area. And Mount Loretto is managed grassland. So they actually mow it every year to make sure that it stays a grassland, that it does not become a forest. And that's because there's so little grassland in our area that birds really need this habitat. So it's a very cool spot to look for some of those birds. And then we have High Rock Park. This is in Staten Island's Greenbelt. It is beautiful forest, lots of really great hiking, and a spot that I really love to check out for spring and fall migration. There's also ponds, so it's a really great spot to look for birds. So we're going to wrap up. This is my last slide. So if you have any questions for me, you can put them in the chat and Joanne will let me know that you have questions. If you'd like to get in touch with me, I can do this program for any class or group in New York State. And that's my email address. So you can get in touch with me after today to do any of those programs. So Joanne, I'm ready for you to take it over and let me know if there are any questions.
So thank you so much, River. It's always a pleasure to watch your presentations. And so before we begin our audience Q&A, as River has mentioned, if you have any questions, please write them in the live chat and we're going to be answering them right now. Once again, a big thank you to River for your presentation, and another big thank you to the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. I know that there were some questions about this, so yes, this event will be available for viewing after. I just put the link in the chat for our Science Saturday playlist. All past events are there, as well as upcoming programs that will be happening. In addition, please like and share this video, as well as subscribe to the QPL channel to get more updates on similar upcoming programs, and hope to see everyone on March 13th for Nature and the Effects on Sustaining Better Mental Health Care, which I'm going to put in the chat. Now onto some of the audience questions. So first, there were a lot of people who said hello, which is always nice. Other questions. So just in terms of a statement, when you were talking about tracks, Shirley mentioned that opossum and raccoon tracks look very similar. There was a discussion happening about pigeons. And then Shabir G asked, is Jamaica Bay open right now?
So as far as I know, Jamaica Bay is open. The trails are open. So as far as I know, the trails are open to the public, and then the nature center, I think, is closed. I could be wrong about that, so it's best to check with their website. Whenever you visit a spot and you're expected to go into a building, I would check the website ahead of time. But I think the trails are open to the public still.
Awesome. So Eleanor was asking, where is River's contact info? And so River, if you want, let me actually reshare your slideshow with the lovely, lovely giraffe GIF. And if you don't mind, I will type out your email in the comments for people.
Yes, R2Ed is how you get in touch with my office. And happy to do this presentation. We also have a bunch of different presentations that we can offer.
Awesome. And so another question. So I'm always amazed when you were talking earlier before that there are coyotes in Queens. I know you briefly mentioned it. Would you mind going a little bit more into detail with that? Because there was a moment I was like, what? So talk a little bit more about that for me.
Yeah, so coyotes are a species of animal that is always really surprising when we talk about animals that live in New York City. And that's because we're used to them being in more wild areas, open areas, and they're also really good at hiding. So even if you spend a lot of time in New York City parks enjoying the outdoors, it's still really unlikely that you're going to see one because they smell us way before we get close to them. And they're really good at running away. But there is habitat for them, so they can find their food, water, shelter here. And I don't know why they're seen around the airport so much. Maybe just because it's a big, wide open area. And when I've seen coyotes in more wild spaces, I have seen them more in like open grassland type areas. So maybe they're thinking that they can find food there. Yeah, I'm not sure. But and coyotes have also been seen in parks. So in Central Park, there has been a coyote seen in Central Park and sometimes in Prospect Park. So yeah, they should be staying away from people, but that's a good reason to not feed animals because the more that they come close to people, the more they can scare people. So yeah, they're around. They're pretty cool. If you Google coyotes in New York City, you'll see articles because whenever it happens, it makes the news. They're not very commonly seen.
And so to add on to what you had just said, Arlene has said that coyotes are in Northeast Queens and that where she lives in Douglaston, Little Lake, they have sighted a few actually. Other things is Shibuji said, thank you. Robert said, nicely done, River. Thank you so much. Mary Lou at the beginning said that she was really excited to see this and she's going to actually be sharing with her students at NYU. So thank you, Mary. Please feel free to share any of these videos, as I mentioned. A question that someone has also put in, Shirley asked, what kind of habitats do the coyotes need? And are they expanding into any of the other boroughs?
That is a really good question. So coyotes in wild habitats, which I'm separating from urban habitats for this presentation, coyotes in wild habitats are usually in grassland areas and they are hunting small rodents. Rabbits are a big part of their diet. And sometimes they'll eat eggs. So sometimes they'll dig up like snapping turtle eggs that are laid in the ground a lot. Coyotes will eat them. So I'm not sure if they are expanding in other parts of New York City. I don't have that like in-depth information, but there are wildlife biologists that are keeping track of the coyotes. And a big part of how we find out their range is by looking at the scat. So we can find coyote scat. It doesn't look like any other animal scat. Fox scat is a lot smaller. So yeah, I'm not sure if their habitat is expanding, but basically if they are in an area where they can find small mammals to eat, they will be able to survive there. And coyotes are not carnivores. They will also eat plants. So because they have that generalist diet, a generalist is an animal that can eat a lot of different things, that they're able to survive. So they are definitely a part of Queens for sure. And I know that they have been seen in some of the other bigger parks. They're around.
And so someone also mentioned that Greenwood Cemetery has been offering similar education programs this past year. And there's a great assortment of wildlife there. Mary was mentioning that they're offering some programs in Staten Island on the North Shore Parks. Arlene has mentioned the Alley Pond Environmental Center, which is really cool. Thank you all for your recommendations. In addition, I did want to go back to Greenwood Cemetery for a second, because like as you mentioned, it's not a place necessarily you think of looking for birds, but there's a ton of birds there. And I've heard that there's some pretty interesting stories about why that species is there. Would you be able to expand a little bit upon that?
Yeah, so there's a pretty wide habitat range at Greenwood Cemetery. So if you look at a map, you can see that Greenwood is almost the same size as Prospect Park. So it's a huge area. So when birds are flying over and they're looking for a spot to rest or a spot to potentially nest, Greenwood Cemetery looks pretty much as good as Prospect Park. And there's a lot of spaces there that are open. So birds that are birds of prey, raptors, can find a spot to perch and then look for prey running around. When I was walking around Prospect Park a couple days ago, I actually saw a bald eagle flying through Prospect Park. And when I saw this eagle, I've never seen an eagle in Prospect Park. I did see a bunch of people with binoculars, and I gravitate toward people with binoculars. Those are my kind of people. And I said, was that an eagle? Did I just see an eagle? And this woman started telling me that the eagle was seen in Greenwood Cemetery and was hunting in Greenwood Cemetery a couple days before and then had gone over to Prospect Park. And there's really great networks of people that are reporting when they see cool animals like that, and a really cool app that you can put on your phone to learn what animals are in your neighborhood is called iNaturalist. So that's all one word. It's the letter I and then the word naturalist, and you open it up and it's map based, so you can zoom right into your neighborhood and click on the different dots and see what people are seeing. It works a little bit better on the computer if you want to look up ahead of time what you're seeing, but the cool thing about the app on your phone is you could take a picture of anything out in nature, a bird, a plant, a mushroom. You can upload that picture to the map and other people will help you identify it. So that's a really great tool that you can have right in your pocket to help you have a better experience and try to get to know your nature neighbors a little bit better.
Awesome. And so on that note, we are going to end today's session, but thank you so much again, Robert. It's always a pleasure to have you on our Saturday series. And so for everyone who's watching, thank you for joining us on your Saturday as well. And please set a reminder for our next event, which is Nature and the Effect on Sustaining Better Mental Health Care, which we're going to be having next week, same time, 2 p.m. The link is in the chat. Once again, thank you again so much, everyone, and have a wonderful Saturday.